good afternoon and welcome back to the Touchline, a fan favorite segment, the fan zone, where Sam Gitahi joins us. Of course, I'm an United fan, and considering United have been performing poorly, what do you think about the game is coming up next at 6 p.m.? You are up against
Watford.
Yeah, an easy one.
No, it's not an easy one, especially going by what their manager does in Claudio Ranieri. We know he can play good football, and we've seen them actually come up with good results. You saw them beat Everton quite easily, so it's one of the games where, again, we'll keep on talking about, it's a last game for maybe Ole Gunnar Solskjaer to maybe find a result from somewhere. We hope he's going to, because many have been talking about him and maybe he's not good enough for Manchester United. This is a game he should win. If he loses, then I guess he should go.
Of course, Steven Gerrard back in the Premier League, also eyeing that position to be in charge of Liverpool sometime in the future, considering Jurgen Klopp also era is almost coming to an end. After winning in Scottish Premier League with the Rangers, now he's back in the Premier League, where he played football for a long period of time as a skipper for Liverpool. Now, this time round, in charge of Aston Villa. And talking about Aston Villa, they are taking on Brighton at 6 p.m. East African time. Big challenge for Steve G?
It's a big challenge for him, because I don't think the Scottish League is that competitive compared to the English Premier League. He went there, won the league with Rangers. They had not won, I think, for the 10 years. They had not won a league there, and he gave them the league. So a good play for him to start his manager career. But now, coming on to the Premier League and taking over Aston Villa, it will be a tough sell for him, because the Premier League is a tough league, and we have seen former players taking the teams. We cannot say Steven Gerrard is not good. He has already put his mark out there with Rangers, but with Aston Villa, it's a new challenge, a new beginning for him. He has to start away from scratch and see what he can do and what he can offer Aston Villa.
But I love that appointment. Okay, in as much as I felt like it was a bit of a gamble, everything with coaches right now is a gamble. So
yes,
getting into the Villa job, my biggest worry about Aston Villa when the manager was in charge was about the conceding of goals, because you look at in the Premier League table, it's only Newcastle and Norwich City who have conceded more goals than Aston Villa.
Yes.
Well, at that time, they have Tyrone Mings in there, and they've got some good defenders like Tuanzebe, who's also part of the team. They've got Konsa, they've got Matty Cash and Matt Target. I think Steven Gerrard is one manager who I've seen in the Scottish Premier League impose himself on the players, and he gives them some kind of a lift,
yes,
especially with what he's done also in his career. So yeah, I would expect them to finally solidify their defense. And then you look at the signings that he had done with Leon Bailey, Emi Buendia. I think he has a soft landing in those kind of players, because he's just going to lift them up, and maybe they're going to spark on.
So Steven Gerrard, a man who performed distinctively as a player, despite the fact that, you know, he didn't win himself, I think, an English Premier League title with Liverpool,
yeah,
but Champions League, remarkable one in 2-0-5 against AC Milan. Can he replicate his glittering career as a player to now managerial position in a league which he played all along?
I don't think you can answer that question to certainty, knowing what happened, because
the dynamics of coaching in the Premier League.
Yeah, former players coming onto the game and they do not perform that well, and there are those former players who came onto the league and they performed very well. So I think it's all fans giving him a chance to put his blueprint out there for Aston Villa and see what he can offer. The good thing is, he's an obsessive manager and he knows what he wants. Even from the way when he was a player, he was obsessive as a player, and you saw that with Rangers. So for Aston Villa, players know that now they have got a coach who will determine to get everything that they have to offer onto the field of play.
Eddie Howe, former Bournemouth tactician, at some point being linked with the coaching of national team Three Lions, but now back to replace,
Steve Bruce,
who was sacked at Newcastle United.
Yeah.
A good coach, but what are his chances of succeeding?
Well, right now his back is against the wall. He needs to survive, and I guess that was the big thing that he has to achieve right now. You know, as you look at the consortium taking over the club, I think the only thing that they need right now is to stay in the Premier League, because you couldn't imagine a team that is so rich and it's in the Championship.
Yes.
So for Eddie Howe, I don't know whether it was that a brilliant signing for Newcastle United, but as I understand right now is that they are in the search for a director of football, and I think that's what they really need right now. going into January, probably they're going to get in some few names during the winter transfer window, get a few guys, and maybe they're going to survive. But my issue is on today, actually, when after they play their game today, they are going to have a very rough kind of fixture in December. So right now you look at them, second last in the Premier League, you would expect they'll still be there. And I think it's not good for them to be around that position when Christmas time is around. So he'll have to take his chances, but it's good that he has three of his players that he has worked with at Bournemouth, you know, the likes of Callum Wilson, and he also got the likes of Ryan Fraser. Probably he can get the right men there with Saint-Maximin also there in Almiron. I think he's going to survive though.
Getting linked with several players currently featuring for Manchester United, that is Newcastle United. They're linked closely with Anthony Martial, who else, Eric Bailly, Jesse Lingard, and Donny van der Beek.
I think
their breakthrough, do you think it depends on how they will be busy during upcoming transfer market in January?
They have got to be busy, but I don't think it will be that much, because people expect that now that you have got owners who have got a lot of money, they will give you money to go and spend. But at the end of the day, they're also looking themselves as a company. Are we spending? They will need a return on investment. That's why they are looking at this player and everything. But Eddie, I understand today will not be on the bench because of COVID-19 and everything. But he's a good manager. I think you saw what he did with FC Bournemouth and everything, and when they do not back him up after I think 3-4 years, you saw how FC Bournemouth started going down. But if Newcastle back him up in January with some of the good signings and the players that they have at the moment, they will not be relegated. They will still fight to stay in the top league.
And I guess that big question about who they are going to bring in. Right now you looked at how long they stayed with Steve Bruce in charge, and then they stayed a long while without having a manager who would come in with Graham Jones, who was the assistant manager at that time, was the manager then. You're talking about a consortium that really doesn't know about football. You can agree with that they pretty don't understand what's going on, and they don't know what to make the right moves.
Yeah.
So the director of football is really needed right now, because you talk about him at Bournemouth.
Yeah.
He didn't have the right kind of signings. You know, he bought Dominic Solanke around 37 million,
yeah.
John Arriba around 30 million, and they didn't work out at Bournemouth. So he needs some savvy guys that are going to bring in some good ideas and maybe bring in the right players at January.
It has been a season of, you know, firing and sacking of managers. Dean Smith also left Aston Villa and now he's in charge of Norwich. Big assignment for him, considering the team he's taking care of is facing relegation at the tail end of the 20 team standings.
Well, to be honest with you, looking at even the other managers that have been brought in, I think he has the least pressure, because I've not been a huge fan of Norwich City for the longest time.
Yeah.
In as much as they come into the Premier League and then they go back, I call them a yo-yo club. And I guess right now, looking at Norwich City, the condition they are in, I don't think you can find three clubs that are worse than Norwich. I think they are destined to get relegated again this season.
Yeah.
So for Dean Smith, I think, for me, he's trying to steady the ship. It would be much of an overachievement if he does remain into the Premier League. But then if he does go down, he'll try and recover them back into the Premier League. He's done that with Aston Villa. So right now, I guess he has the least kind of pressure. But looking at them after winning their first game against Brentford, they still have some very good players. I'm a Werder Bremen fan, and I know about Milos Rashica, I know about Josh Sargent. They can do a good job for him. Matthias Norman has looked good from Norway. So if he does achieve and maybe finishes above the relegation zone, it's a huge plus. But I would expect that they're planning for life in the championship. Yeah.
On to our fixtures for today. Cristiano Ronaldo, just from international break with Portugal, and he played a few games against Serbia, which they lost unexpectedly, contrary to a lot of people's expectations, losing against what people call Minos. And now we've seen his tweets and his post on social media that is back at the back of him and prioritizing what is ahead of him for his team. Can they bounce back from the previous defeats before international break?
I think they lost to Man City 2-0 before the international break. I think this is a game where Manchester United can have a reaction. They can actually return on top and score some good goals and bring that kind of good feeling going on to the next matches, because I understand they've got, I think, Chelsea after this one.
Yeah.
So this is a game where they will need a reaction for that, and they will need players to come back in full swing. The thing is, we don't know how Ole Gunnar Solskjaer is going to set up his team. Is he going to get a team that is a winning team, or is he going to get a team that does not start on the front foot to get the goals that United needs?
And there's been lots of reaction actually when they left for international break, because the team actually went down for holiday for around a whole week.
Yes.
And guys really were frustrated in that Man United, having watched performances and going out for a whole week. But listening to Ole Gunnar Solskjaer talking about maybe how he's going to set up, he's had an issue with maybe having a back three.
Yes.
Of which he says that it doesn't really work well, and you saw it against Manchester City in the second half when they went back to a back four.
Yes.
And the team looked a little bit brilliant. So right now with Rafa Varane out, I would expect that he's going to go with a flat back four. The issue with the midfield is that Scott McTominay picked up an injury. He didn't play for Scotland. He might be out. So he answered a few questions about Johnny van de Beek, and he said that he's a good player. And we saw even the applaud from Man United fans when he came on in the second half against Manchester City, in the second half against Atlanta. He looks like a very good player. Probably he's going to be thrown today into the midfield. And I guess the other guys are okay, apart from Paul Pogba, who's out again. I think he'll be out up to next year.
But the before, big before he leaves the team, because
yeah,
that looks like it is certain he will be leaving United next season. Though it depends with how his contract will be, you know, the terms.
But the biggest game actually this afternoon before
Leicester Chelsea.
Leicester Chelsea is a big one. Liverpool Arsenal coming on to the late kickoff is a big, big one. But Leicester Chelsea, will this be the first game where Chelsea can drop points?
Well, they've already dropped points. They dropped points to Burnley.
Yes.
Well, I've looked at the lineups and it's the relief for Chelsea because they've got back Mason Mount, who had a few issues with wisdom teeth.
Yes.
And
guess they were growing over it.
Yeah, he had a few issues. They had to be taken out and had some painkillers there and missed the games for England.
Yeah.
So it's good that he's back into the team. And then at the back, we've seen a tweak. He's changed Andres Christensen.
Yes.
And he's brought in Trevor Chalobah, who I think is a very brilliant player. But I guess in that combination, Chalobah and having Thiago Silva, who has come in from Brazil in the international break, I guess Jamie Vardy will be looking at that and feeling like I should go there and try and fancy something there.
Yeah.
But I have a few issues about Chelsea. You look back at their games ever since they played against Malmo. They've been having issues putting away teams, scoring the second goals and such things. You look at the Burnley game.
Can that be without because of Lukaku is not in this team? Or
I thought it was about Mason Mount, the kind of link that they needed, because you look at the Burnley game. Ross Barkley was the man who was behind all those chances and he ended up spanning them all. So right now with Mason Mount linking up with Kai Havertz in the front and Callum Hudson-Odoi, I think that would be a really good combination going against Leicester City, who have a few issues on defense. I've seen also Brendan Rodgers has gone with the back three, probably to try and curb those three. I hope it works for him, but they are lacking Ricardo Pereira, who is out, and they've decided to use Michael Brighton as a right wing back. We'll see how it goes, but I would expect Chelsea to come up with a win.
They are using Rhys James and Ben Chilwell
as the wing backs,
but playing alongside midfielders. That's a strategy as well.
Yeah, he, of course. Thomas Tuchel has always used the 3-5-2 formation, 3-4-3 formation. I beg your pardon. So, Rhys James, we've seen him in the past few games for Chelsea, and also even in the international break for England. He played in both matches and had assists in there, and also scored twice against Newcastle United. That's the strength that Chelsea have at this moment in time, because when you're having wing-backs, and that's the issue I had with, I don't know, Bissaka being a wing-back, he needs to be really good offensively, bringing in the right crosses. And I guess with that, playing against Marco Brighton on one side and Castagne on the other, I think they're going to have a field day there.
So later on at the tail end of today, of course, big game, Liverpool up against Arsenal. Can Arsenal end their jinx against Liverpool and record the much-needed victory?
I think if you could have asked me that question 3 years ago, to told you there is no chance in how they would have done that. But I guess right now, looking at the streak they are on, I think they might have a chance against Liverpool. And Liverpool, looking at their fixtures that they've had even in the past, you compare them to maybe Chelsea and Manchester City, and you look at the goals they've conceded. Liverpool have conceded 11 goals in the Premier League so far. And there's been an issue with Trent Alexander-Arnold being a right back for Liverpool.
Yeah.
Because you go back to the Brentford game, you go back to the Brighton game, you go back even to the West Ham game that they lost. They've been targeting Trent Alexander-Arnold.
He's tired or something.
Yeah, and it's that he goes up too high, and forgets maybe to track back because he's pretty much a winger. Yes. And he tried out being played as a winger and it didn't work, so he has to play as a right back. So that has got to be an issue for Liverpool. The other thing is about injuries. They've got lots of injuries in their team. Look at Milner, you look at Keita. Sadio Mane also had a bit of an issue when he was playing for Senegal against Togo. I think that should really lean into their minds. Henderson, 75%, I guess, is maybe nailed on to start, or maybe he wouldn't start. Yeah. Curtis Jones also has an injury. So maybe you're looking at maybe Origi might be involved into the action, or maybe Takumi Minamino, and of course Alex Oxlade-Chamberlain might be thrown in there. So Arsenal might be looking at this and feeling like this is an opportunity for us. We might actually go there and win. And looking at how solid they've been in the Premier League with Gabriel, with Tomiyasu at the back, and also now it's a good thing that they've got Partey back into the team. Smith Rowe and Saka are playing so well. This could be a really exciting game.
I was looking at their stats. I think even after Christmas, and Arsenal looks like the most improved team.
Yeah.
Forgetting the three first matches they played in the league, they lost the three of them. But from them, they have gone 8 matches unbeaten, adding on to the Champions League, the Carling Cup match, and they have, I think, 10 matches unbeaten now. Mm-hmm. And you look at that streak, and going on to Liverpool, where they haven't won, I think, since 2012,
yeah.
It gives them a bit of a
motivation
to go against Liverpool. No, hey, you lost against West Ham.
Yeah.
You lost points against Burnley. So we can also try and get that point from you.
Yeah, because Arsenal and Mikel Arteta, they have been undergoing that kind of a process. They've been calling it trust the process.
Trust the process.
And I guess right now it's clear as day that the process is clearly working.
Yeah.
And those acquisitions that they had with Tomiyasu, a right back position, is working so well. I don't know whether Kieran Tierney is going to be back a left back, but you've seen Nuno Tavares is working so well in there. Ben White has been another revelation.
Yeah.
And also looking at Aaron Ramsdale, he's been playing balls of football, and even he got his opportunity for England in the last game, and he kept a clean sheet. Having Smith Rowe and Saka, as I said again, these two young players are really showing it in the big games. And I think looking at the fixture that Arsenal played, maybe you could say it was a kind of a pancake kind of a, of a run, but this game they should try as much as possible.
But Liverpool is coming, Arsenal, a big match that is coming there, but one team that people are forgetting and also is a very, very good team has got to be West Ham.
Mm-hmm.
Look at the way West Ham has been playing of late since David Moyes took over. They are now in the top three.
Yeah.
They are playing against Wolves also. You expect to get a win for them there?
I do, and I've listened to David Moyes, and the good thing about them is that even when you study about their backroom staff that they have, they have former players who are around that team, the likes of Stuart Pearce, they've got Kevin Nolan in there, and they've really brought in some very good players.
Yeah.
I mean, when you go back to Zuma, he scored even a goal against Liverpool. He's looking like a really good defender. Actually, he's the highest paid player at West Ham at this moment, and he's showing it on the pitch.
They are going to miss Ogbonna.
Yeah, that's the big issue. But also when you talk about depth that they have, the limited depth that they've got, Craig Dawson is there. He's around 37 years old, but he can do it. He extended his contract at West Ham. They still got Adam Asuaku, who can also come in. The issue about them is that how do you balance the Premier League games and the Europa League games, because they're coming in thick and fast.
Yeah.
And Mikel Antonio has been a man that's been rested and has been given the opportunity to only play Premier League games, rested in the Europa League games. Whenever the injuries rack him, it's going to be a big issue for them. But David Moyes has said it clearly that he wants to finish in the top four, so you better watch out.
And considering that how a club trusts their own, you saw the owner of West Ham paying, I think, £100,000 to fly in Mikel Antonio all the way from Jamaica to England. But forgetting about the Premier League, also a big major change in Barcelona. Xavi Hernandez coming in as a coach for Barcelona, and everybody saying this is the change that Barcelona needed. Is he going to perform for Barca?
Well, I've been questioning myself about what is really what intentions the board has for him and what he should achieve. I guess at this moment, looking at them around 9th and 10th in the Spanish La Liga, I would guess finishing in the top four would be a huge plus for the team. And maybe it was a good assignment for him, because he'd stayed for a while before getting himself ready for it. Coming in from the Middle East, I know it doesn't help because there's really not much competition in there.
Yes.
But I've seen already he started in with some kind of tough mentality there. He's brought in the rules, and one man has been at the back end of those has been Ousmane Dembele.
Yes.
He's been having a few issues with truancy. And all I can hear right now is all talk from Xavi. Yeah. I would really love to see him do in the field. And he's talked about Felipe Coutinho being a man that he will definitely use in this period. He's got a few young players that maybe can buy into his ideas, the likes of Gavi, Pedri. Yeah. You've got Ansu Fati here, there.
And he's brought back Dani Alves.
He's brought back Dani Alves.
And but for me, I look at it and I say, Dani Alves, it's not majorly about playing football, but how he can run that dressing room.
Yeah, I also think so. That should be the issue, because when you are asking what happens to Serginho Dest now as a right back, but I would guess he's that kind of a guy that will bring back the dressing room together, even the likes of Gerard Pique, and try and show these guys how they should play football.
Yeah. His first match will be against Espanyol tonight at 11. And Espanyol is a big game between Barca and Espanyol. So. Yeah.
Rivalry is expected to be renewed.
Yes.
Wow. It's been a nice show this particular Saturday afternoon. 1 to 3, talking about matters happening, sports, both local and beyond. Of course, this time round, talking about football, because it has been the main topic. Though, as we speak right now, a lot is happening in athletics. You know, big guy, Andrew Amonde, his celebration party this particular evening after, you know, playing for the national team, the Sevens, and announcing retirement, celebration in his favor is being organized this particular afternoon at a Nairobi hotel, and a lot of dignitaries have been invited to attend. Is big man to have graced the game, right?
Yeah, he's one of the Kenya rugby players that will go down into the Rugby Hall of Fame for Kenya. Was one of the players who guided Kenya to the Singapore Sevens, our first HSBC Sevens title. I think that was way back in 2016, and he has been performing for Kenya at the Olympics, and you have seen what he has done also for the Shujaa Sevens and for the KCB Rugby Club. And so it's a good one for him as he retires, and now we hope for future good things for Andrew Amonde.
Sure. Yourself, you've been keenly following about basketball in the US. How is it like?
Well, it's looking very good for my team, the Golden State Warriors. They look so good. They are the best team in the NBA at this moment in time. We've got the Phoenix Suns, who are on an 11-game winning streak, and they are looking pretty good. For the Lakers, it's pretty different. They are losing games.
I know, right?
And
things are bad.
For the first time now, they've got a losing record. King James is back. We hope that maybe they're going to turn the tide. But Russell Westbrook is a man who needs Jesus right now.
I saw Shaq saying that the best team at the moment to win the championship will be the Golden State.
And you look at the depth that they've got, they are able to rotate their team. You look at that 13-man roster that played in the game against the Brooklyn Nets. I guess that's the kind of game that maybe put them on the map and saw them as serious contenders. Yeah. The Golden State Warriors are going to win the NBA championship as long as Kyrie Irving doesn't return to the Brooklyn Nets.
Sam Gitai, a man who sleeps, eats, and drinks football. Every time you're waking up at night at round 2, maybe you're not aware of a fix in basketball, Gitai is already posted it on his Twitter status. He's catching up a game until you get tempted. Oh my goodness, now I will have to interrupt my sleep and also catch what is happening. Of course, he's been joining us this particular afternoon to share his views on English Premier League return and general European leagues come back after international break. A lot is expected. We wait to see what will happen this particular evening. Arsenal against Liverpool, as a United sympathizer, hoping that, you know, Arsenal pulls a surprise. Let's continue with the conversation. Hashtag touchline Y254 at Wasike Maxwell, at Osorobats, at Y254 channel. Let's continue talking and see what is the future of Kenyan football, even as the battle between, you know, Football Kenya Federation and Minister of Sports continues. CS Amina Mohamed looking forward to crack the whip, and she seems unstoppable because she said that, you know, the government will be in charge of football going forward. We wait for caretaker committee's assignment in the next 6 months and see how the elections will pan out to give us the new person who will be at the helm of football. You haven't talked about, you know, local football. What's your take over what's happening?
Lots of suckers, you know, in there, but I hope that this caretaker committee is the one that is going to bring some sanity into the Kenyan football, because for the longest time we've been having it being run like a kiosk, I would say. So I think it's a relief side for anyone who loves Kenyan football. So that would be my take, and I hope that we are going to go into the right direction. Apart from that, I would like to tell everyone to have around 4 screens today, because we've got lots of action. The Bundesliga is back. The Qatar Grand Prix. And you remember that Bayern Munich lost a game yesterday. Yeah. Borussia Dortmund would be willing to win today and get back to a point closer to Bayern Munich.
Yeah. Max Verstappen or Lewis Hamilton?
Lewis Hamilton all day.
Good day. Keep safe and God bless you. Enjoy whatever you're doing.